What's my horse's handicap?
The fact that you're backing him.
Everyone loves a newbie. That's why Paddy Power Games are giving all new customers 60 free spins on daily jackpot games. New Paddy Power Games customers only. One per customer. T's and C's apply. 18+. BeGambleAware.org.
Welcome along to another anti-postcast here. That's right, we're dipping our toes into the water. Last weekend in July at Ascot. Back at Ascot we go for the King George. It promises to be a purler. Let's get our teeth stuck into it. Delighted to say that Nick Watts joins me in the studio. On the line, ever-present Tom Segal, Pricewise, and of course, Darren Hughes from Paddy Power. Darren, let's go straight to you. Let's have a little look at the market and we can go from there. I'm assuming Enable must be a bit of a warm order now.
It's one of the safest assumptions you've ever made, Dave. Yeah, she's our 4-6 favourite. We initially opened up in around the 10 to 11, even money mark, but we're absolutely smashed off the boards. So yeah, Enable is our 4-6 favourite. Crystal Ocean then for Michael Stout is 7-2. Anthony Van Dyke is 7. Defoe is 12. Japan is 16s off the back. Some negative words made in O'Brien. He's probably not coming here. Magical is 16s. Massara is 16s. Sovereign, the Irish Derby winner, is 16-1. And it is 20s bar.
Interesting market then, isn't it? I mean, look, Watsy, let's face it. You spoke to me as we were coming in on this show. You just said she wins, doesn't she, Enable? Just give us a brief line about her comeback, you know, what she's looking like now. She's just brilliant, isn't she?
Yeah, she is. It's all been said about her, and whatever challenge she's seen to John Gosden gives her, she rises to it and does it. I mean, you know, she could possibly have been vulnerable heading into the Eclipse first time out, of course, against race fit rivals, etc. But, you know, she just won comfortably, and there was a sense of inevitability about it from quite some way out. And I think the most remarkable thing about her, you know, we've seen some great horses in the past, and, you know, but every horse tends to have peaks and troughs. You know, they have times when they're brilliant and they can't get beaten, and then they might be a little bit rusty on their return and they're building up to big races. She never seems to have those peaks and troughs. She seems to turn out every single time. I think Frankie Dettori mentioned it afterwards, that all of her wins have been at different tracks. So she does it left-handed, right-handed. She can handle undulations. She can handle different ground. She won this race a couple of years ago. She thrashed Ulysses that day, you know, won very, very comfortably indeed. And I think that's the most remarkable thing about her, is that she just retains her appetite for the game and looks, you know, even though this is her fourth season of racing and, you know, she might have been expected to have become a broodmare by now. She just loves racing, and that was again evident in the Eclipse, and nothing could get nearer. Magical couldn't get nearer, even with kind of race fitness on her side, you know, ran a great race, but couldn't really lay a glove on Enable. And she sets a very, very stiff standard for anyone in this race to aspire to, and her presence might make a few of these melt away.
Yeah, fair play. Tom, let's go over to you then. Enable, odds on, obviously worthy of that price.
Yeah, obviously. Obviously, Nick, spot on. What more can you say about her? She basically wins every time she runs, isn't she? Always in Group 1 company too as well. Well, the thing is, you know, we're here to try and find some alternatives. She's 4-7, isn't she? Or were you 4-6 there, Darren? I think you said 4-6. You know, plenty can happen in 3 weeks' time. Don't know what the ground's going to be. There's the bounce factor to throw in. I don't think it's probably a problem for Enable, but she must have had a hard race. It's Sandown, it's an Eclipse. You know, she'd have had to put some effort in. She's got to bounce back. 4-6, different track, different day. Do I think she'll win? Yes. Would I back something against her each way? Yes, certainly would.
Okay. All right. Fair play. Darren, give us a quick line on Enable before we move on. Try and find something juicier price-wise around the place.
Yeah, look, I'm not going to rehash what the lads said. All I would say, and I'm just playing devil's advocate here, and like, look, she's brilliant, and fair play to her owner for keeping her running. But for me, she has yet to reach the level of her very first ARC win for a second time. Now, she's come very close to it. And I'm not saying she's necessarily weak or she has weaknesses, but she mightn't just be the gimme that everyone is making her out to be. Now, that said, I think somebody went up 7-4 for the King George in the immediate aftermath on the weekend, and that was just silly. Like, they were slapped down fairly quickly, and the odds on is a correct price, but she's the right price at 4-6. She's not value at that, I wouldn't say.
Okay, that's interesting. So we're getting towards some value. Crystal Ocean, Nick, second in the race last year, second to Enable when they met, of course, on Polytrack at Kempton last September. Any chance of reversing that form?
Well, if you're looking at alternatives, if you're trying to find an alternative to the favourite, then obviously Crystal Ocean has to be the top of your list. won last time out. Again, won comfortably and magical, a good barometer for the form, obviously, you know, so you can get some kind of form line there. I'm not sure Crystal Ocean is, well, having said that, neither would Enable, neither of them would probably at their peak of that Kempton race last season. So I wouldn't really draw too many conclusions from that. You know, Crystal Ocean this season has definitely taken quite a step forward for me. You know, I used to think he was better over further, a mile and a half. So obviously that plays to his advantages here. But he seems to have got a bit of speed to his game as well now, and won over a mile and two, and won very comfortably, I thought, Ascot last time. Magical couldn't quite, you know, get near him in the home straight. She had a good shot at him, but couldn't get the job done, and he won quite comfortably. So this is the obvious place to come for him. He is the obvious danger if, you know, if Enable underperforms. And he always runs his race. And, you know, older horses, Michael Stout, it's all there for him to run very well. I'm sure he will.
The figures are quite interesting, Tom, aren't they? I don't know if you've had a look at the RPRs from Saturday yet. We gave Enable 1.24, whereas Crystal Ocean got a 1.28 at Royal Ascot. Is there any juice in around about 3-1 in his price at all?
Well, on the figures, on those figures you've quoted, of course there is. And if you look about their general, they're even at their best Racing Post ratings. I think Enable's £1 higher than Crystal Ocean. She's getting the £3. So, you know, so basically Racing Post ratings said if they're running off level weights, they'd expect Crystal Ocean to beat her. I personally don't think that's right. I think she's ahead of Crystal Ocean by a bit more than that would suggest. But nonetheless, Crystal Ocean's a very, very good horse. As Watsy said there, if he's improved this year, which I think he has, then he's right there with her on what he's shown this year. Definitely is. Whether he's tactically as astute or tactically as brilliant as she is, I think that's the thing about her. Enable is why she's so brilliant, is that you can put her, you know, she's got so much tactical brilliance and awareness about her. You know, I'm pretty sure on Saturday, you know, the O'Brien team were trying to get in front of her. They were trying to get Magical in front of her to try, you know, so that she'd have to come past horses. But like in the Arcs, she just can sit where she wants in a race. She'll sit second, third. Crystal Ocean will probably have to go behind her because I don't think he's as fast as her, and then try and get past her up the Ascot straight. I think it's unlikely, but I don't think it's impossible, put it like that. And therefore, would I back him at 3-1? No, I think that's about the right price. Come the day, if he's 3-1, I might have a few quid on him. But at the moment, we're, you know, 3 weeks before the race, no, not for me.
Darren, what about you with Crystal Ocean? Just brilliantly consistent horse, isn't he, basically?
I'm going to be a little bit stronger than the lads here. I think this is potentially the best horse in training. I think he's improved an awful lot, or in Europe, certainly. I honestly think there's not that much between him and Enable. Now, whether or not he can give her £3, I don't know. I think he's improved a good bit again this year. His run at Royal Ascot was definitely a career best, and you have to say the conditions on the day wouldn't have suited him. It was 10 furlongs on soft ground. He's a mile and a half horse who needs fast ground. So for him to be able to put up a performance like that on the day in those conditions tells me he is a lot better horse this year than he was this time last year even. And, you know, he fits the profile of a horse like that. He's a Michael Stout horse. They improve with age. They improve with time. He takes his time with them. For me, this is a 9-4 shot. This is not a 7-2 shot. And for me, at 7-2, he's definitely a bet. He's my selection for the race. I don't mean to put out any spoilers, but I think 7-2 is an absolutely brilliant price.
I was getting the idea that you might be about to put him up there. I have to say that, Hughes.
Darren, you've spoiled it. They were all waiting for you at the end. And look what you
so much done. For the value 20-1 shot that we were waiting for. Well, we're warming up now, lads. So what about this Defoe, Watsy? He really has turned himself inside out this season, hasn't he?
No chance, Dave.
He has to a degree.
Whoa, Tom.
Move on, Dave.
Tom.
No chance.
Yeah, we've got to give him a bit of... We've got to give him a word. He's just won a Hardwick. He's won
move
a Coronation
on,
Cup.
Come on.
No, I'd agree with Tom. You're exactly right to say he's taking a leap forward, but if he won the King George beating Enable, beating Crystal Ocean, I'd be very disappointed, and I think they'd have to run quite a long way below their best for him to try. I can't... Yeah, he's, you know, he won at Epsom, didn't he? I still can't quite believe that he beat Kew Gardens that day. So he's found something from somewhere, but this is a real elite race, and I don't think he's a real elite horse.
He's not a postponed then?
No.
Fair enough. Okay, well, we know what Tom thinks about Defoe. So, Darren, are you a Defoe fan, or is this a penalty kick he's going to miss out on?
I think what Nick said there is spot on. I think if he was to win this race, I'd be a touch disappointed. And that's nothing against the horse. Like, he obviously has improved hand over fist this year. I mean, like, it seems a long time ago now he was getting stuffed by Marmello last April, you know, literally out of sight. His last two runs have been stunning. He did me no favours when he nutted Kew Gardens that day at Epsom. But, yeah, look, he's probably not quite up to this level. There are softer grade ones or group ones throughout the year that he can maybe pick up.
Right, okay, let's get to the three-year-olds. This is the important bit for me, I think. I was really hoping they were going to run Japan in this race. It looks at the moment now, Tom will come to you on this, it looks as if they're going to go to France with Japan, doesn't it?
Yeah, France for Japan most likely, and the two Derby winners, I'm told, are coming here. Sovereign, who won the Irish Derby, who I think everyone sort of thinks it's a fluke. I'm not totally convinced by that myself. And Anthony Van Dyke are the Epsom winner.
He didn't run too badly at the Curragh, did he, Anthony Van Dyke, Tom?
Oh, he looked a bit slow to me, if truth be told, Dave. Mm. I thought he was better than that. I thought he'd come on again for the Derby run. And it looked to me like he just was a bit laboured. I mean, maybe it was the very fast ground. Maybe he doesn't really like it.
That's interesting.
Is maybe what I think. Also, obviously, the tactics went up the spout and that wasn't supposed to happen. And we all know what happened there. But I just thought he was a bit laboured from start to finish. He looked like a slow horse and I thought he was better than that. I really did. So I'd be surprised if he could, you know, you normally need a really, really good three-year-old to beat the older horses here, and I don't know, they get a bit of weight. I'd be surprised if Anthony Van Dyke would be the one. I think Sovereign's is quite an interesting horse, actually. I think I think the time figures and everything about it will tell you that his Irish Derby win wasn't the fluke that everyone thought it was. He seemed to me to be the best horse from start to finish. He didn't get hit by the whip, I don't think. He won by six lengths. Yes, obviously he had the run of the race around the Curragh. But I thought it was the first time he'd been allowed to race on his own, do you know what I mean? Without being sacrificing himself. They obviously were planning on sacrificing him, but around the Curragh it didn't pan out that way. I thought he might run a race at 25-1, might hit the frame. I don't think he's got any chance of beating Enable or Crystal Ocean on what he's done so far. But of the two of them, I wouldn't be surprised if Sovereign beat Anthony Van Dyke again.
Interesting. Watsy, what did you make of that Irish Derby? Was it a fluke? Or does Anthony Van Dyke have strong claims?
Yeah, it's funny. I was watching that. I was on holiday with the missus in the Peak District when that race was going on. I had to
constantly away, this bloke.
I had to try and get a signal on my mobile phone, and I was I was just about able to watch it.
It's not like broadband up there, do they?
No, exactly. It kept flickering in and out. I thought, what's this thing in pink that's gone so far clear? And I had to check the race card to see what was going on. But I would tend to agree with Tom because Sovereign did get the run of the race, but he managed to burn off Norway, who was up with the pace as well, who weakened into third, and Anthony Van Dyke managed to get past Norway but couldn't get anywhere near Sovereign. So it's one of those, you know, initially you look at it and you're scratching your head, but you know, from wherever he's found something, and I don't think it was a fluke. So he could run better than his 25-1 price suggests here. Will he win? I can't see it happening. And the fact that he could beat Anthony Van Dyke suggests that, I don't know, maybe the three-year-olds are a mixed bag. I'd very much expect the older horses to hold sway here. And yeah, no fluke last time, I don't think, but a place is the best he can realistically hope for, I think. And you're probably looking at third.
Okay, looking at third at best then for Anthony Van Dyke. Darren, are you more of a fan than the other two of Anthony Van Dyke, Derby winner?
Well, I just want to divert slightly. I kind of do wish Japan was rocking up here. Yeah. I think he's the best three-year-old in training by a mile. Myself and a good pal of mine, Aidan McGrath, we had Japan to win a fortune to win the Derby this year, which just, I think, only for his setback. I think he'd have won it with his mouth open. He's comfortably the best three-year-old I've seen anyway. Just a line on Sovereign. I just did a bit of research on this last night. You can say whatever you like about, you know, he got an easy lead, he got this, that and the other. I'd echo what the lad said there. As they said, like, he burnt off Norway and hit the time of his Derby, the only time quicker in the last 10 years, was Trading Leather in 2013. And just to put that into a bit of context, he was quicker than Latrobe, Capri, Harzand, Jack Hobbs, Australia and Camelot. And they're all very good horses. Now, I know there was different ground conditions, but most of those were on good or good to firm. So, I mean, you can't say it was a fluke. It was a brilliant ride as well, in fairness, by Cora Peggy. It was delighted for him. But I think he's going to be underestimated in the market here, I think.
Okay, that's interesting. Well, what sort of price is he at the moment? Just remind me, Darren, what price Sovereign is with you guys?
16-1, which would look big.
Okay, fair enough. So, bit of love out there for Sovereign. Now, the Prince of Wales' stakes is usually a leading pointer for this. Assuming that Magical's going to have a break, well, it looks like that's going to be the case. What about Massar? Is he going to turn up? He's due to run at Newmarket this week, isn't he, Watsy?
Yeah, I couldn't have Massar for this, to be honest. you know, obviously good Derby winner last season, but had a long break after that. It might be that he comes back to himself by the autumn and he'd be more interesting for races around then. But I thought his, you know, his Ascot return was okay. I just think it's a big ask to send him back into this if he does go for it on his second start. I think he might just need a bit more time to you know, to re-find himself, as it were. You know, I can't see him off the back of the preparation that he's had and, you know, all the time off troubling a race fit Enable and Crystal Ocean. So he wouldn't be for me even at, you know, double figure prices there.
Okay. Tom, correct me if I'm wrong. Did you put Valgeist up during Royal Ascot Week for the Prince of Wales?
Yeah. I did indeed, yeah.
He ran well, didn't he? Considering he just couldn't come from off the pace in that race.
I don't think he likes soft ground either. I think the key to him is quick ground. I think he'll run well. He would be my choice selection again. I know he was beaten a long way by Crystal Ocean, beaten 4.5 lengths, but he was about 4.5. He was probably more than 4.5 lengths behind him turning for home.
It's the key to him not staying in France, Tom, for God's sake. He's never run to himself outside France. He doesn't like travelling with us.
Don't worry about stuff like that, Darren. He's 25 to 1. He's 25 to 1 for that man. He can't complain. I mean, I think he's a really good horse. I think this will be the race that suits him. Will he win? Can he beat Enable and Crystal Ocean? Probably not, but he's 25 to 1. 20 to 1, whatever he is. I think he'll run well. I think he's the one horse in there which has the latent talent to run with them. I don't think he can beat them, maybe, but I think he can run with them. And if he got the run of the race, which is tricky because the French horses tend not to round Ascot. I think that's more the key than the worry about him running out of his home country. I think that they just tend to sit back and wait. And Frankie's just brilliant. He'll sit second on Enable. They'll have to come past him. Crystal Ocean's a strong stayer up front. Can Walgeist run them down? Probably not. Do I think he's the third best horse? Yes, I do. And therefore, that's why I would suggest him each way.
Okay. So, Darren, you're not keen on Valgeist?
Sorry, I agree with Tom. I think he's a massively talented horse, but, like, maybe I'm being silly, but just his record outside of France is a massive concern. He's run below himself in Britain and in Asia as well a couple of times. It's just, that's a concern to me. I thought he ran okay at Ascot. The conditions wouldn't have been in his favour. But no, like, at 20-1, fair enough. I'll never put anyone off one at that price, but he wouldn't be for me. Massar, no good. Ivy Theory last year's Derby was absolutely pants. He beat a stayer in DXB and two non-stayers in Roaring Lion and Saxon Warrior. They just didn't get home. And I mean, like, DXB has only run okay in, you know, staying races this year. I don't think Massar is up to scratch at all, and I wouldn't back him at twice the price he is.
So keeping with the Godolphin theme, Cross Counter, if you turned up here, what's he?
No, I don't think so. Obviously tried the Ascot Gold Cup last time, didn't quite see it out. It might take him quite a bit out of him, that race, I think. So going over a mile and a half here, I think he'll just find it too sharp. I think 2 miles is probably his optimum trip. Just briefly, if I was to have an an each way play in a race, it would be Kew Gardens if we knew that he was going to go there. Why he didn't turn up at Ascot, I don't know. And I don't know if he might have had a setback or, you know, because he didn't obviously turn up anywhere. But he's got good Ascot form in the book, won at the Royal Meeting last season. Don't know quite what happened at Epsom in the Coronation Cup. I don't think it's quite his track. If he was to run here, he's 20 to 1 or whatever, then I would give him an each way chance. Although if he had an injury setback at Royal Ascot, then we'd just have to, you know, play it by ear and see, you know, get the vibes from the stable and see if he goes. If he goes, I'd give him a squeak.
If he's decked up, his price will contract. Yeah, I'd agree with that. All right, and chaps, so before we go for selections in the King George, is there anything else on the list that you'd like to touch on? The likes of Coronet, perhaps, or anything like that? Tom, we'll come to you first.
No, I'd go back to Cross Counter with Watsy there. I think he's a mile and a half horse myself. I think he won the Melbourne Cup through sheer brilliance myself. I think he ran down some really good stayers on the back of when he was given a really average ride, in my opinion. I think he's got the course record at Goodwood over a mile and a half. I think a mile and a half is his trip off a strong pace. I agree with Watsy, I think he's had a terrible preparation. You know, you couldn't get a worse preparation coming into this than running 2.5 miles on heavy ground, on soft ground at Ascot. So that's my negative for him. Without that, I would have been quite keen on him to run really well, because I think the trip will suit him, a strongly run mile and a half.
And Darren, anything on the list that you want to touch on that we haven't looked at?
Just one, and it's not a massively confident selection. It's Guyot or Riot or whoever you pronounce it, the Godolphin horse train in France. I know Tom Collins on your side is very fond of him, thinks he's a monster. I know, look, Wild Guy's fairly left him for dust last time out, but I thought he ran a little bit too bad to be true, and I might be willing to give him another chance.
He's a miler. Darren. He's a miler without a shadow of a doubt. He can't stay this trip.
Potentially, yeah, I won't disagree with you. Like, I to be honest, in this race, might be just a little bit too hot to be giving him a second chance, and you know he's given away to a few of them, etc., etc. So I'd sooner see him maybe in calmer waters than this. But he's not a horse I'd give up on. I'll put it that way.
Okay, all right then. Okay, so Gaeth, I agree with that. Actually, I think he's potentially a little bit forgotten. And he's got a 120, I think.
Stay the trip, Dave. Absolutely no chance of him winning this race.
Just been shot down by Tom Segal.
He's a miler, full through and through.
That'll teach me to put my oar in. Okay, chaps, so let's get a selection from you then. Darren, let's go to you, seeing as you got in there really early. Crystal Ocean all the way?
Crystal Ocean all over him, yeah. I think he should be 9-4.
Okay, what's he?
I think Enable will win, but if he turns up, Kew Gardens, a big price to finish in the frame if he goes.
And Tom, Waldgeist, the biggest danger, you think?
Well, I've already done a few quid in this. I've backed Sia Class, unfortunately. I hope she pulls through. Yeah. I've backed Magical, who Time Told's not running each way. And so I'm a few quid down already. I'll probably end up a few more quid down because I'll back Waldgeist each way if he's 20-1.
And for what it's worth, I'm a Waldgeist fan each way as well. Okay, moving on from the King George. Big races also that weekend. We've got the Moët & Chandon International Stakes, completely changing tack. One of the biggest handicaps of the summer up the straight mile. Okay, we've got the likes of Kinran in here, who's surely going to have his day sooner or later this season. But Darren, before we go and have an in-depth look at the runners, can you give us a drop of the prices, please?
Sure can, Dave. Yeah, no 4-6 shot here. You won't be surprised to hear. Kinran is our 8-1 fav. Land of Legends is 10s. Vanar is 12s. Raising Sand is 12s. Borman is 14s. Labrisa Breeze is 14s. Mutarafa is 14s. Beauty Philly is 16s. Blow by Wind is 16s. Blue Mist is 16s. There's several more there at 16s and 20s bar as well.
Some well-known names on that list. Tom, I want to come to you first. It's interesting, isn't it? Because Kinran is probably, I'm assuming, an anti-post favourite you might be wanting to take on.
Well, I love the horse. I think he's one of the unluckiest horses in training, if I'm honest, Dave. I think he's been drawn so badly so many times, but keeps going up in the handicap for getting beat, doesn't he? Ran another cracker in the Hunt Cup the other day on the far side. He was well backed again, wasn't he, into 11-2 favourite. I think Connection still think he's got a bit in hand. Personally, I'd be worried about fast ground for him. I think he needs a bit of cut in the ground. Would I back him at 8-1? No, I wouldn't.
Kinran, what's he?
No, I'd agree with Tom. A bit of digging the ground would probably help him. There's a few of those in the same boat. I think Raising Sand, if the ground had a bit of cut in it, would suit very nicely. And Blue Mist is probably another one to put in that category as well. But, you know, if it's traditional summer weather and we get good to firm, then it might inconvenience them. The one I was massively interested in was Land of Legends. Completely different horse to kind of Kinran, very much at the start of his career. I think he's only had 4 outings. Go back to his debut second, he ran King of Comedy to 3/4 of length at Yarmouth. I mean, that obviously looks, in hindsight, fantastic form. He's won his last 2, won on his handicap debut at Newmarket last time out. If there's one horse who could potentially be, you know, quite a bit ahead of his mark, it could well be him. So I'm not surprised to see him at the top end of the betting, and he would be much, much more interesting for me than Kinran, this Land of Legends. I think he's a very interesting horse.
Yeah, 3-year-old against some much more battle-hardened handicaps. Darren, which way are you looking in this race?
There was 2 I was interested in, a 3rd one I would have been, but I'll touch on him last. The first one I kind of half-liked was Hey Jonesy. Be a big fan of him. I've mentioned him on the podcast before. His run in Ascot behind Kate Byron, he looked like he'd appreciate an extra furlong. That's what it looked like to my eyes anyway. I don't know what the lads might have thought. I know Tom is kind of a fan of him as well. He's run well at Ascot before. He's run well in much better races, group races, over sprint distances. And it might be just a thing that at this stage of his career, the extra furlong could be a big help to him. And he's 20-1 there, so he could be worth a stab. He should get in as well off of Market 105. Another one then that I liked was Maxime. He's been given help by the handicapper, dropped to a Market 98 from, I think, a high of about 105 a few races back. Now, the caveat with him is that he does need digging the ground, so he'd be one I'd wait until near the time to have a few quid on. And then the 3rd one, who was an absolute handicap certainty, only he got the worst ride I've ever seen in my life, is Turgenev. What Frank Dettori was playing at, he has absolutely destroyed the best handicap plot in Britain. Worst ride I've ever seen. What did the lads think?
Tom, we'll go to you on that one.
It wasn't great. It wasn't great. And I think Frankie would be the first one to admit that. He was my choice, actually, Turgenev. I think he's a good thing. I think he's got a massive, massive chance. I think 7 furlongs is perfect for him. I don't mind he's gone up £6. I don't think that makes any difference. I think he's just a really, really good, well-handicapped horse back at his favourite trip. He'd be the one for me without a shadow of a doubt, Dave.
Okay, that's interesting. So it's a couple of three-year-olds getting some love. Now, I've got a bit of a cliff horse in here.
Uh-oh.
I think a lot of people are probably with me on this one. Spanish City. Oh, come on. I mean, he's going to fall over the line sooner or later again, isn't he? Just or is this one I should just jump with?
Well, I had him on, you know, coming into this today, I didn't kind of note it down as on the shortlist kind of thing, because he'd run well 6 furlongs last couple of times. He looks like he wants to return to 7. Yeah, so I think the trip's right for him, definitely. So, yeah, he's somewhere in the mix. But, you know, I mentioned Land of Legends earlier, I'm very keen on, but the boys mentioned Turgenev too, and I can completely understand where they're coming from with that. I think they're two very, very solid options. So Spanish City, you know, you could run better for this step up in trip, but it's not kind of enough for me to be wanting to go out and you know, put some money on him. I think he could run well and finish in the top 10, but I just think those two in particular are really, really solid at the, you know, the front end of the market.
Yeah, what about William Haggis, Dave?
Yeah,
he's very good at these races. He's having great form at the moment.
Yes, he is.
Lots of winners at Sandown. Mojito was impressive, wasn't he? Got a couple in there. One I liked was the filly Island of Life or something.
Oh, that's another cliff horse for me.
Knight of something. What's it called? Do you remember it?
It's Island of Life, isn't it? In the
Island
red colours.
Island of Life.
Oh, Tom.
Island of Life. Third to...
painful memories of watching
Invincible
this.
Invincible Army the other day. Got a very slowly run race that. Invincible Army got a easy off the front there, and she shot home in a group 3.
Yeah.
I think 7 furlongs is her trip. I think she's about 33-1. If she was to turn up, I think she'll run much better than that. Island of Life, she is. That's right. You've got the name. I'm rubbish at names. I'm getting old. I can't remember names.
Don't go there, mate. It's Monday as well, isn't it? Let's face it. Yeah, so there's two cliff horses for me there. Spanish City and Island of Life. What price is Island of Life, please, Darren?
She is a 25-1 shot there, Dave, for Tom. I should just say as well, while we're on this race, we are 5 places, which no one else in the industry is on this race. Everyone else is only 4, so you have a good chance of getting a few quid out of the race if you're having your bet with Paddy Power.
I've got a feeling my selection, Spanish City, will need the 5 places again. And I like Island of Life as well, Tom. All right, chaps, let's wrap this up. Let's get some selections. Starting with you, Watsy.
Yeah, I'm going to go with Land of Legends.
Just all in?
Yeah, all in. Yeah.
All right. Okay, Tom.
Turgenev first, Island of Life second. There we go. Forecast done.
Boom. And over to you, Darren.
Hey Jones, he'd be my bet in this race. And if there was a drop rain around Ascot in around that time, I'd have a few quid on that team and a beat price as well.
Marvellous. Okay, well, let's hope you've enjoyed this racing podcast. My thanks to Nick Watts, Tom Segal on the phone, and Darren Hughes from Paddy Power as well. I'm Dave Orton. Let's hope you've enjoyed the show. Don't forget to view, rate it, of course, YouTube, Twitter, or whatever it is. We'll be back shortly on the racing podcast.
Here at Paddy Power, we're the home of the Money Back Special, with some incredible offers every single week. Check out the website or app today. Terms and conditions apply. 18+, begambleaware.org.